कॉलिंग रानी सर।
हाँ जी दुबे जी,
ये लोग उनसे बोल रहे हैं जो फेस चालू कराए हैं।
आपकी मर्जी दुबे जी।
तो हम चालू करा रहे हैं सर,
कोई दिक्कत नहीं है।
इट्स ऑन।
I've been moving calm, don't start no trouble with me. Trying to keep it peaceful is a struggle for me. Don't pull up at 6 a.m. to cuddle with me. You know how I like it when you loving on me. I don't wanna die for them to miss me. Yes, I see the things that they wishing on me. Hope I got some brothers that outlive me. They gon' tell the story, shit was different with me. God's plan, God's plan. I hold back, sometimes I won't, yeah. I feel good, sometimes I don't, yeah. I finesse down Western Road, yeah. Might go down to G-O-D, yeah, wait, yeah. I go hard on Southside G, yeah, wait, yeah. I make sure that Northside E. And still, bad things. It's a lot of bad things that they wishing and wishing and wishing and wishing and they wishing on me. Bad things. It's a lot of bad things that they wish and 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 on me. Yeah. Hey, hey. She say, do you love me? I tell her only partly. I only love my bed and my mom. I'm sorry. 50 dub. I even got it tatted on me. 81. They'll bring the crashers to the party. And you know me. Turn the 02 into the 03, dog. Without 40 Ollie, there be no me. Imagine if I never met the broskies. God's plan, God's plan. I can't do this on my own, ayy, nope. Someone watching this shit close, yup, yeah, close. I've been me since Scarlet Road, ayy, road, ayy. Might go down as G-O-D, yeah, wait. I go hard on Southside G, ayy, wait. I make sure that Northside E, yeah. And still, bad things. It's a lot of bad things that they wishing and wishing and wishing and wishing they wishing on me. Yeah, yeah. Bad things. It's a lot of bad things that they wishing and wishing and wishing and wishing they wishing on me. Yeah.
Ting from barking, 7 a.m. in the morning. She's calling, I'm yawning. She's jarring, no stalling. I might link my ting from barking, 7 a.m. in the morning. She's calling, I'm yawning. She's jarring, no stalling. I might link my ting from barking, 7 a.m. in the morning. She's calling, I'm yawning. She's jarring, no stalling. I might link my ting from barking, 7 a.m. in the morning, she's calling, I'm yawning, she's jarring, no stalling. I'm icy, I got a tick from my head to my feet, that's Nike, and that's pricey. You see them guys over there, they ain't like me. I got a Portuguese thing, not wifey, she said my temper's tiny. I got two different worlds like Miley, you hit me up, that's unlikely. But I walked in the rave with a fresh trim, sharing my Colgate teeth. Yeah, they're looking at me, saying, can I get a pic for the gram? Just like AJT.
Good morning, everyone. A very warm welcome to all of you. I am Farah, assistant professor at Sushant University and your host for the event. So thanks a lot for joining us for our webinar for BFA, that is Bachelor's in Finance. Let me introduce you to our first speaker. So we have Kartikeya sir with us, the Program Director for Bachelor of Finance. He'll walk you through the exam that we have to offer. Kartikeya sir, over to you.
Yes. Good morning, everybody. My name is Kartikeya. I've been teaching in Sushant since 8 years now. And I'm really excited to just introduce you people to our newly launched program of BFA in Applied Arts. And I must say that art has been always integral to architectural education in Sushant. And we have a very integrated art course curriculum. And taking it further, we plan to introduce few BFA courses in which our first initiative is Applied Art. And I'm going to share a small PPT with you people before we start with our main topic. This PPT is all about what applied art is in general and how our course, which we are offering in Sushant University as part of School of Art and Architecture, is different from, I must proudly say, from all the other universities in India. So I'm just going to show you a small PPT on this. Just give me a second. Farah, can you confirm my screen is visible?
Yes, sir, it's visible. If you could put it on presentation.
Yes, thank you. So, as BFA courses are professional courses, UGC approved professional courses, and they are 4-year degree course everywhere in India. We are also launching a 4-year UGC approved degree course. And there are many unique points about our course here in Sushant. I'm going to discuss each and every point with you people. And we are really looking forward in getting some really interested, talented students for over this new course coming semester. So first the question is, what is applied arts? So applied art is a kind of very broad, diversified subject. And speaking from a very conventional point of view or from a layman's perspective, applied art is something, you know, in which you tend to deal with application-based skills. And when it comes to art, usually art is considered to be something which is the sole purpose of art is to give us pleasure. Applied art is something very unique because it is art, but it is a kind of art which not only gives us pleasure, but also fulfills a social utility purpose. And that makes it very unique. That makes it more meaningful for the culture, for the society, for the whole humanity. So it's a broad subject area combining three very important components. One is the aesthetics, other is design, and third is the consumer needs. So the aesthetic part is what I was talking, that the sole purpose of, you know, art, the first purpose is to give us pleasure. That with design comes the creation, that we have to construct something which is meaningful for the society, which people can use. And the third is the client or the need or the, you know, the functional purpose which we are creating, which at the same time is aesthetically pleasing but also has to fulfill the purpose of the client for which we are creating that product. So applied art is characterized by this very important components: aesthetics, that is its capacity to give us pleasure, the feeling of beauty. Second is the design, that is the creation part. And third is the purpose for which we are creating it, whether it is fulfilling that purpose or not. So that is what basically applied art means. So it is basically acquiring of application-based artistic skills, artistic skills, which has certain functionality through which we can perform, which can fulfill certain functionality. Second, Applied art aims at finding aesthetically engaging practical solutions to problems, as I was discussing with you people, and creating objects and ideas that are intellectually stimulating, useful, and also beautiful. So as I just discussed, there's three important components. Usefulness connects to the need of the client, its practical functionality. Beautiful connects to its aesthetic aspect. And intellectually stimulating has to do with both practicality and also to the fact that it is aesthetically engaging to us. So these three are very important. That is why applied art I consider to be very challenging. It's a very exciting profession. It's a very challenging profession. And I consider it that I take applied art as a very holistic kind of, you know, term, which includes all the design disciplines also. So I'm really proud that in our department, we are launching this wonderful course, which is very holistic and very different from other applied art courses. I will come to other aspects of applied art. Now, there are many applied art related disciplines. As I was discussing in the beginning, that applied art is a very diversified field and it has evolved into many complex disciplines because of new media and computer technology. As you know that now we are living in this modern age, technology is playing a very important role in our lives. And traditionally speaking, applied art was something, a kind of art which had a functional purpose, although it was capable of giving a feeling of beauty, but it has a functional purpose, very well-defined functional purpose. So traditionally speaking, applied art was something which was limited to mainly crafts and decorative arts. But until a more recent times, to that of the print media. But now, these days, applied art, because of the new media and computer technology, it has diversified itself into very interesting disciplines. Speaking of its more recent associations with the print media, applied art is very meaningful when it comes to illustration, publication design, packaging design, and marketing and advertising campaigns. And when it comes to new media and computer technology, we have motion graphics, we have user interface, UX and UI, we have web design. And of course, graphic design is part of both the print media domain also, and also the UX, UI and motion graphics, because graphic design is something very basic. It means that how we visually communicate our messages, how we communicate with our users, how we communicate, how we translate our messages visually in a powerful manner. That is what graphic design is all about. So whether it's print media or whether it's virtual, graphic design is very much relevant for both the platforms. Then we have product designers, and in the last we have visualizers. So in this way, you can see applied art is very exciting. It gives you a lot of opportunities. It really, if you are something who don't want to just simply shut yourself in your studios and work as per your subjective instincts, but prefer to come outside, share your ideas with people, want to connect with the world, then applied art is, and you think you are creative, then applied art is a course which definitely you should go for it.
Okay.
So I will just move on to the next slide. So I will just give you a slight brief about what are the applied art related job profiles, and there are many. You can work as graphic designers, illustrators, art directors in advertising agencies or firms. You can work as 3D modelers or visualizers in architecture and design firms. You can work as animators and visualizers, and they are in huge demand in media and entertainment industry. You can, if you have a theoretical bent of mind, you are more interested in books and all, then of course you can work as curators, art historians, critics, and also as exhibition designers, working for museums, art galleries and art events. You can work as, if you're into teaching, you want to share your ideas with the community, with the students, with the kids, then you can work as art educators and teachers. And if you are not interested in working for some client, for some company, you're not interested in doing a 24-hour job or a full-time job, then you can work as freelance, self-employed photographers, or even full-time practicing artist or freelance applied artist. So there are many opportunities available. You can, after your graduation, you can select any of these profession as per your skill set and your area of interest. What we are doing in Sushant, we are offering you a module which is going to give you, train you in all these aspects. And I must proudly say that you are not going to lack anything. You're going to learn each of these disciplines. And you can see that in many colleges where we are students are offered separate degree in visual communication or in animation, our course in applied art will make you full-fledged in all aspects of application based disciplines, which are in great demand today. Okay, so it's a very rigorous course. I will just talk you now about our main USPs. So as I was just discussing in the beginning, that art has been integral to the course curriculum at SSA since its conception and beginning. So we have three important factors which gives us a very good edge on the other colleges in simply in Delhi NCR, but also in India. First of all, we have a very innovative curriculum. We are working under SSA, which itself has proved itself in the field of architecture. Our students are well placed. Our architect students are well placed both at national and international level. They are working in big firms, and the strength of it goes to our faculty and innovative curriculum, which we are following in SSA. The same curriculum on the same lines has been designed for the applied art, in which the traditional skills is also given importance. At the same time, new media fluency is also there based on a holistic training. Second is the opportunity to work with interdisciplinary and collaborative approach with architects and designers. This is something very important and very one has to understand this, because in most of the foreign universities you see where there is a applied art department or a design department is always working in collaboration with architecture department and other design related disciplines, because you know these things are very interconnected, and these days the possibility of interdisciplinary approach has become too much. We cannot survive in the coming years without having an interdisciplinary and collaborative approach. So already we are functioning under SSA, which is a full-fledged, fully developed architectural department. And we are very glad that we have SSD also under us, the School of Design. So the applied art students will get a lot of opportunity in terms of exposure and getting in touch with architects and designers, and they can really expand their skill set. And they will complement each other. There is no doubt about it. The third aspect is that the university is located in Gurugram, Delhi NCR, which itself is a hub for a lot of multinational agencies, animation and gaming studios. So that gives you a lot of opportunity, whether you want to work in Delhi, Noida, Gurugram, or you want to go to other IT hubs like Hyderabad, Bangalore, or Mumbai. So these are some of the USPs. And I just forgot to mention you that applied art is a course in which after doing your graduation, a lot of opportunities gets, you can avail a lot of opportunities when it comes to your master's. If you want to do post-graduation, you can go to NID, you can do a design degree, you can do a mass communication degree, you can do a MFA. So there are a lot of things which you can pursue. It gives you a lot of opportunities if you do a BFA in applied art. Secondly, I will just discuss the main points that how this, in what way our curriculum is so innovative, and why I'm stressing this point that we are training you holistically. First of all, we have a lot of importance given to, like in SSA, we have a lot of importance given to critical theory and art and design theory. So lessons in history, aesthetics and criticisms is part of the course structure from the very beginning. In foundation, you're going to expose to fundamentals of art, then aesthetics, then art history, and also history of visual communication and design, which is lacking in so many applied art colleges in India. So this theory component is very strong. Plus you have an advertising theory module, which starts from the second year and goes to the fourth year. And we have some very experienced faculty coming committed to teach this design theory course, who has been teaching in prime institutes or in good government colleges since past 25 years. So I'm very proud of this theory component. The second is the manual skills and the digital skills. So as I was discussing applied art has diversified itself into a lot of disciplines because of the new media and modern technology. So training in old and new methods of production will be there, no doubt, and there will be no compromise on it. But also making use of computer-based applications for drawing, illustrations, and graphics designing will be strongly there from the second year onwards once you are through with your practical hand-based skills. Secondly, contemporary trends and industry exposure. So when it comes to contemporary trends in applied art, the use of digital communication, augmented reality, UX and UI, and other interactive media is what makes the big difference. So that is going to be there. And the internship will be, you will be exposed to internship more as compared to module running in other colleges. Okay. So my next is, I'm just going to discuss very fast what are my core modules, which makes our course really unique. So one is the graphic design module. This will start from the second year onwards and will continue till the fourth year, where it will, in the last two semesters, it will translate or transform itself into communication design, as it will become more user experience and interface design oriented kind of module. So in the beginning, every aspect of graphic design work, from logo, poster, banner, books, magazine, press layout, packaging, to its application in branding, technical and artistic drawing, signage, photography, image and video editing, 3D modeling and its usage in motion graphics, programming and other design related fields such as user experience, UX and interface will be there. And this, as I told you, that as you move more towards your fourth year, you will switch on, you will move from the print media towards more experiential sort of, you know, usage of graphic design in present times. Second is the drawing, illustration and the 3D visualization module. This is one of our very strong point, where other colleges are offering you a separate degree in animation. We have integrated the animation into our applied art module. And we have integrated as such that once you go through this rigorous module, you can completely work as a full-fledged animator once you get a degree in applied art. So we are going to give you a lot of importance on 3D visualization. We have even broadened its scope. It's not simply animation related with certain effects, but it will be studying animation and motion graphics very holistically. So there are a lot of opportunities available with this. So mastering of all the necessary and required manual and digital skills related with the illustration. Starting from 2D animation like cell, flash and pixels, students will learn all the latest techniques and softwares, mastering 3D visualization techniques, exploring the domain of motion graphics and after effects. And trust me, we have really pitched in industry people who are working in the industry to teach this animation module. So there will be no compromise on the, what is expected out of this module, and you will get the best. The third is the communication design. As I told you, that the graphic design will be, converted into communication design as you move towards your higher semesters. This module will add an experiential dimension to graphic design, using it for web designing, marketing, and branding purpose, which is so necessary in today's time. Main emphasis will be on web sticker, banner, animation, and pop-up, and students will learn the tools of digital communication, focusing on how to use online platforms like Facebook and Instagram for promotional purpose in a user-friendly and interactive manner. In the end, student will go beyond print media, exploring the digital and the new media platforms for their campaigns. So you're going to make your campaign in a very holistic manner, in a very, contemporary way, using all the latest technological equipments and the conceptual knowledge required in order to be the best in your field. Third, this is also one of our biggest USP, which I believe, and students are free to compare the electives which they are getting in other art colleges or design colleges and what kind of electives we are offering. We are going to make you fulfill all your sensibilities when it comes to, because many applied art students, they have a lot of different kind of sensibilities. Some of them might want to do, have a kind of, bent of mind towards fine art, so they can explore, electives like painting and digital art. Or they can even try their hand at site-specific art and installation art. If they are more into social context, they can try with the public art. We have club public with the site-specific art. Then we have information and interaction design, which is specifically meant for the students who are still want to stick to their core modules and want to explore it further from a design perspective. So we are going to run this in collaboration with SSD. Secondly, being part under the architecture department, we have a very exciting elective called interior architecture and exhibition design, which is going to give you an upper edge if you're going to pursue your freelance work. Thirdly, we have mobile journalism, which is also a very exciting elective because applied art students are open to masters in mass communication, and mobile journalism is a really very exciting upcoming discipline. Then we have augmented and virtual reality. All those who are into computers and programming, they can explore this. We have environmental graphics, which is very holistic, very relevant in today's time. Many of you are still interested in branding and all to a larger extent, so they can opt for social media as marketing tool. Then if you have a more scientific bent of mind and want to understand your customer's mind and the what makes your product more relevant, then you can opt for psychology and behavior science. And then in the end, if you are more you're more keen in using modern technology for fine art purposes, then you can go for the new media studies. So these are the some bunch of very relevant electives which we are offering in our applied art course to make it totally holistic and up to date. So in the end, I would like to tell you that doing this course from our university is going to greatly benefit you in all respect. I'm fully confident that our graduates will get maximum benefit in terms of growth and employability because of their diverse skill sets, as the program tries to address all the aspects of and related disciplines of applied art from a futuristic viewpoint. They will find themselves in great demand in multinational agencies, media and entertainment houses, and animation and filmmaking studios. They can choose to work as graphic designers, illustrator, art director, or visualizer, depending on their area of interest. In the end, I would just like to give you a little bit of exposure that these are some of the offices of many multinational advertising agencies, media and entertainment houses, and animation and filmmaking studios, which are located in cities like Gurugram, Mumbai, Hyderabad, Kolkata, and Bengaluru. And these are all, these animation filmmaking studios, and at the same time, agencies like JWT, Publicis, Gray, and these are some, superb agencies where you can, start your career, launch your career, and within you few years, you will be really excelling in your field. So this is something which I want to share with you, and I'm really looking forward for a very exciting response. So now I will come to the, I will just introduce you to today's speaker. Just give me a second. Yes, today we have special guest with us, my colleague Kumud Ranjan Halder, working as assistant professor in Sushant School of Art and Architecture. And he's a very experienced guy from the applied art discipline. He completed his bachelor's from Fine Art in Government College of Art and Craft in Kolkata in 1990s. And he has over 30 years of professional experience in various disciplines related with applied art. And he's really an asset to us. He has worked as an illustrator, a game visualizer, interior designer, workshop instructor, and he has worked in many multinational agencies and organizations like Publicis, J. Walter Thompson, Nahar and Galaxy Studio, Bani Chakra, V Being, Metamorphosis, Film Junction. And he really has a lot of experience when it comes to applied art related disciplines. He's also have been quite active as an artist, finding time in between his, all his working as an applied artist in during these times. He also, practice as a fine artist. He has exhibited a lot in many galleries, and he's a recipient of many awards at college and national level, such as Government College of Art and Craft Annual Award for the Best Painting and Rajasthan Patrika Award for the Best Print Media Illustration 2006. So I will just now switch on to my colleague Kumud Ranjan Halder, and he's going to give you a short presentation on the value of art as a universal tool for communication. So Kumud sir.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes, yes, you're audible.
Okay, okay. So you have to stop presenting, then I can start.
I think I, sir, I stop present. I stop presenting.
Oh, okay. So is my screen visible?
Not yet, sir.
Okay. So just give me a second. I hope now it's visible, right?
Yeah, it's visible now. It's visible, sir. It's visible. You can just make it full screen.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so good morning, everybody. Today I'm going to talk about how art, you know, works as a universal tool for communication. Art, we all know, you know, it just helps to communicate. And this is one media. So we have, like, you know, two major media. One is spoken, and that is what we call language. To language, we communicate. And another is visual, which is, like, you know, connected with all that we do, like, communicate visually. And another is written communication. So I'll just kind of try to decode how this art is the primitive tool for our expression and, like, you know, and communication. And especially when we have a language barrier, the art can help us to reach across the boundary. Okay, so okay, let us see how it. So art has been a means of expression since the evolution has started. The discovery of prehistoric art suggests that the different forms of art have been practiced since the beginning of the human history. And when human evolution began, there are no languages people used to express through sound, which is the verbal means, which will become the language. And look at this sound, like, you know, I'm trying to play with it. It's how they used to communicate from. So one side of the mountain or jungle, one person used to scream and like send the kind of symbolic sound, then another person used to receive, and that is how they used to communicate. And that transformed the sound, you know, later part of the time, transformed into a music. The music is, like, you know, at times it was, unfortunately I can't play it, but you can listen to any music so that you know that it came from the sound. And when you put sounds in a disciplined way, then that become a music. And the music might have a language, might not have a language. When you have any music which is instrumental, there's no language. But we all get, like, across the globe, when we don't even understand, we don't need to understand any language because it does not have any language, but we just communicate with the rhythm. We communicate with the, so it stimulates our senses. The another medium was gesture, of course. Gesture is, like, you know, body language. So there's a, like, you know, they used to have a, like, sound, verbal sound, and the body language, which is gesture. So gesture become, you know, transform into a theater and, like, you know, films and many other performing art later part of that civilization. So let us see very funny, you know, movies, you know, made out of the Charlie Chaplin. See how gesture works. There's no dialogue there. Sorry for this pop-up. I have downloaded and edited from YouTube. So you can see, like, you know, without language, how the entire expression, all of you have understood how, like, you know, it's like, you know, all the expression you understood, and it's funny, but always the Charlie Chaplin movie is a, like, you know, solid message. Anyways, so let's come to Indian performing art. So that this is also, like, you know, kind of facial expression. It's a Kathakali dance, and Kathakali dance is all about, like, you know, the facial expression. And because of the facial expression, they draw on the eye in such a, you give emphasis to the face in a different color, so it is visible from distance. So that is how you can see without anything. So there's only music and the dance performance, and you can see, you know, there are narratives. So, so as, like, you know, this is Kathakali, then this is Kuchipudi, and of course, there's a Kathak, and so on and so forth. And we have theater also, entire theater thing. So here, the later part, you know, I'm sorry. Later part, this sign language of the people, if there's a deaf and deaf people, there's a sign language through the gesture developed, which I think we are nice. To see the how sign language developed through the gesture, and that is you can see how, like, you know, the deaf people learn that alphabets through gesture, and that is their language of communication. So I stopped there. So you can see that whole alphabet is there, which is developed much later for the deaf people, which is through gesture. Okay. And then another thing is like, you know, visual art. So what is there? Like, you know, there's a sound, then gesture, and of course, the last component is the visual art. Okay, so you can see this is a, you can call it a, like a drawing, painting, whatever, the mural on the cave wall. And this other, like, you know, all those, that whatever the reference we get from the prehistoric art, the reference, this is one of them. So this is like, you know, one visual art, and that drawing and paintings on the cave wall. So that is another form of communication. And this is where I'm going to discuss a bit in detail from there, because it's a, such a, you know, I don't know, like, you know, many of you must be not knowing this, that the all the alphabets came through this art. So that's how, like, you know, when I say art as an as a universal tool, then you need to understand, because our main communication is, like, you know, the spoken or verbal language and the written communication. The language we speak or language we are comfortable with, we write that, the writing communication and the verbal communication. And this writing, developed, you know, throughout the globe, is a, in a different time, in different different country, it developed in a different way. So I'm going to discuss that, how that is possible. So the drawing, the painting on the cave wall, slowly, you know, it transformed into the this things. Sound transformed into music, which you saw. Gesture into theater and other performing arts. Visual art transform into many art forms. One of them is drawing in primitive ages. Okay, so that human beings started to simplify these drawings, which you saw, like, you know, the beginning, it was drawing is another communication for a better and effective communication. How they were simplifying? They're simplifying towards this, you know, more symbolic way. Like when you are taking the axis of any detailed drawing, you get a symbolic. So you can see that this is all the human figure, which is more or less like in a very linear form. This is linear form. From here, you just need to understand, like, you know, like, go back, I'll go take it back. So it is more detailed, like, you know, it is detailed. It was detailed. So it is detailed. There's a body mass, and you can see the, you know, physical body tone. So here you can see, like, you know, it's linear. And here you can see it's basically, you know, like, you know, more of a symbol. So, and it's for the better communication, because when you want to communicate through drawings, you don't have time to, like, you know, paint or, like, you know, go for the detail. You just simply need to communicate someone that this is like birds, human, and whatever. And that is how the, you know, the very, very interesting part of this. That is how all the alphabets, you know, born. And through that alphabets, we actually develop all our verbal language and the written communication. Okay, the symbols evolve into a alphabet. So this is where, like, you know, this is the symbol. You can see that this is a symbol of, like, the house, tree, and birds, and anything. So look, the first known writing system is the concept of pictographs. I'll show you how pictographs look like. Pictographs are basically drawings. Okay, so that my focus is, like, you know, how drawing, you know, transforming into a alphabets. Okay, so that whole journey, and then you know how art is the, you know, tool of communication from the very primitive age and across the globe. Okay, so the pictographs are basically drawings that represent a physical object and are used to communicate ideas. Let's see how the pictographs look like. So this is pictographic script. All of you can see, this is like, you know, that if you follow my arrow, so, like, you know, this is the girl is sitting here, and this is the bird, this is the flag, there are a lot of things, like, you know, this is the, like, symbol of mountain and water, this is the symbol of leaf. It looks like, you know, if you look at it, at a glance, it looked like alphabets, look like, you know, something that steps, but it is all pictures, it is all art, it is all line drawing of those things which is engraved into the world. Pictographic step. And this is another step, is like cuneiform. Cuneiform was a writing system used in ancient Mesopotamia, which is modern day Iraq, I believe, by Sumerians, and around 2500 BC. So the time is like, you know, always can be debatable because it's a history, and it's, someone says it's a 2400 2500, and it's a, but it's a more or less, you know, like 200-300 years of span, like, you know, two things was happening simultaneously. Okay, so but in any ways, the pictographic script is the first writing script, we get it, and that developed to the art, or like, you know, the simplified form of art, basically. So it is a syllabary and syllabary system, which means that every digit represents a sound or syllable. It started as a pictographic system, but the drawing became tedious, because when you are, like, you know, in a hurry to communicate, so you have to draw entire things, so it takes time. So that's what it became tedious. So they were trying to find out something. So it was syllables. I'll show you again the visual. You can see that the syllables, and these syllables, like, you know, they converted it to line, basically. So this, since the, you know, drawing was like tedious or inconvenient, therefore they decided to simplify the strokes of these drawings into lines. So then these simplified drawings began to represent sounds as well as specific words. The concept of using pictographs for their sound is called the rubus. Rubus principle is what, let us see rubus. This is a very modern example, but they had this thing. So, like, let's say this is the bee plus leaf. So that we leave. Okay. So that is the rubus system. So they use it for a uniform language. They use these things, rubus. And after that, you know, this is another thing. This is also, like, you know, happening at the same time it happened in ancient Egypt. So the ancient Egyptian used picture words, again that pictographs, to write for the hieroglyphics. Hieroglyphics is the same as pictographs. Pictographs means, you know, picture and graphs. So this is like, you know, hieroglyphics. The hieroglyphics is that same old form of writing that they starting using the early 2000 BC before Christ, and that is happened in the ancient Egypt. Okay. So this is hieroglyphic. So if you see, like, you know, pictograph and hieroglyphs, this is a very different. Here it's like becoming more and more, you know, going towards simplification, and it looks like the alphabet we know. So let's see the pictograph, and then, like, you know, look at this. From here, and if you go, it's like, you know, it's engraved and everything, but this is written on the wall. So look at this. This is on the flat wall, and it's with the that time, so some kind of naturally, or they got it from the, like, you know, the fat of animal and all other natural charcoal. So they wrote this hieroglyphy things. Okay, and it happened in ancient Egypt, and we'll come to Greece, and then you'll understand what is this. So these are the, you know, some form of pictograph. This is, you can say, the head of an animal, and that's called alpha. Then there's a, you know, there's a things in, like, house, in, like, basically you're showing what in, inside the house, that is beta. And then there's a foot, like a leg, feet. You can see that, you know, the foot, it's like, you know, camel or gamma, delta. So we all know, like, you know, what is alpha, beta, gamma, delta. So this is the very primitive form of these things. Okay. So tendor or pathway. It's said like pathway, delta, A is the behold, da, like, you know, that's a figurative things. Web, you know, that's why. Nail, pig, add, and. Okay. Zine is the, like, all weapon or cut off. Like, look at this. shit. So you can see, like, you know, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. So still it didn't come in that, you know, that order. But it is the, like, you know, that was evolving towards this alphabet. So you can see this is the, like, chet, then tet, odd, calf, lamet, you know, mem, nun, stomach, ayan, kai, test, kuf, res, sign, and calf. So you can see all these, like, you know, it's written there. And if you follow that, you can say stuff. Like, you know, this is the symbol of water. You can saw it here, pictographic script. And this is a sheet. You know, it's a vertical nun. And there's a hand of staff, a support, a prop. So you can see that this is Shemek. So I. So you can see that language. It's I to see or experience. That I am in this pay. It's like mouth, word, or speak. You can see this is the symbol of mouth. So you know, like, you know, how the drawing actually transforming towards the alphabet, okay? And man on side, desire, need, or sun, or horizon. So this is the beginning of the, like, you know, beginning of the, like, you know, our civilization and the, like, you know, the transformation, the symbol to our alphabets, okay? So I'll go to the next slide. So you can see this is, like, you know, Absurd is a writing system that has a character that represents the consonants in Egypt. So Egyptian, they saw, like, you know, they didn't know what about the vowels. Vowel will come much later. So they saw, like, you know, kind of this represents a consonant in Egypt. It's a Phoenician absurd system originated in around, like, you know, it's a much later. You can see, like, you know, there's 3,500 before Christ, and this is, like, you know, 10,050. So it was, like, you know, decreasing. Time was decreasing before the, like, you know, 10,050. So from taking the logographs for common words, then using the first consonant of that word to represent a sound. How that? That is, like, you know, you can see. So these are all, like, you know, you can see the Zion and all weapon you saw there. The oak, wow, book, key, unknown, the death door. All of you, you know, see, this is, like, you know, more of a, like, you can see the English alphabet. Like, much later, so after absurd, there's a, like, you know, this alphabets, the Greek recognize the lack of vowels there and adapted vowels to the Phoenician absurd to form the Greek alphabets, which actually continued till the Greek alphabets has been used continuously since 750 BC. 750 BC is, you know, that much, much later part. So that is how. So look how that there's a vulture, lake, and everything you saw. It's all, like, you know, all this, that water and everything. Now we can see how that, you know, that we can see the English alphabet came from where. So this is the resources. This is the primitive resources that, you know, the drawing and painting. And from there, you know, you can say that symbols, and from symbols to hieroglyphics and pictographics. And from there, you can see much later adapted, like, you know, to English alphabet and the language we write and we speak. So this is how the numbers, you know, created. So I'm not going into detail. So let us see how, what is the ideogram. So in between, there's a China. They developed something almost like 8,000 years ago. China, like, you know, they took this. There's a kind of a debate, but we believe that it somehow, you know, they developed on their own. But some historians says no, they have taken the these references from the, you know, Egypt and Mesopotamia about their basics. Okay, so this is, like, you know, let's see what is ideogram. So that is what important. What is ideogram? And it was of course another you know, primitive form of our communication. So, and this is, all these symbols are, like, you know, pictures. So this is, like, you know, look at this. This is, like, you know, women This is the women plus the roof, shelter and safe place. You can see. So this is ideogram. Why you call it ideogram? Because this is conveying the idea. Why ideographs? So pictographs cannot represent the concept of feelings. Okay. We all saw that the pictographs was all about, you know, saying particular, you know, like, you know, sound or like, you know, creating kind of symbol to communicate, but is it like, you know, it was unable to communicate the feelings. That was still the verbal or gesture or like, you know, like phonetical sound. So ideographs is the first thing, you know, which connects the pictographs and like, you know, the idea. So that how you saw, like, you know, how this is like, you know, the two things together, that idea, two pictographs together creating an idea, and that is called ideograms. Okay, so roof and women save. Okay, so ideograms are developed. Ideograms are pictographs that can represent concepts through metonymy or like in a combination of similar pictographs. Okay, evidence shows it's 8,000, which I already said. So this is one thing, is like, you know, like, you know, all these things are there, you know. I am going to come there, the logographs. So this is what is logographs. Look, this is the you know, ideograms, and this is the logographs. This is what is the logographs. Logographs is a combined, you know, pictographs and ideographs together. So you saw first there's a pictographs and hieroglyphs, and then after that there's a, like, you know, ideograms and then logographs. Combine this pictographs and ideographs together, and that is forming another. So that is how it was evolving. Okay, they are combination that represents whole words. So this is the form of the words, and words will create the sentence that we know. Okay, they began to be developed from pictographs in 5000 BC. So it is like, you know, the time is coming to a, like, you know, beginning of the civilization. It was like, you know, the historic period before. So it was coming from 3500 years to 5000 years BC. Okay, so China, some Egyptian hieroglyphics and the Sumerian uniforms. Okay, they combine that. So this is one thing, is like, you know, it's a Mayan script from the Maya civilization of, again, it's at 2600 BC, southern Mexico. Is the form of this, is the, there's a combination of logograph. The script was written in forms of blocks that would combine the pictographs, ideographs, and to form the words. So you see, like, you know, everything is they're developing, and they adding to another things and developing something for a better communication. And this is also, you can see all, like, you know, drawing picture, you can see, like, you know, many motifs. So this is the motif of this is the face, human face, and then certain symbol. This is again the human face, this is the animal human face, and the, like, you know, the any other motif. So this is the, like, block form that was used in Mayan Maya civilization 2600 before the Christ fall. So through alphabets, language and writing developed, right? We all agree, through alphabets. Once that alphabets developed, you saw how English alphabets developed. Through the different civilization, different countries, they develop different kind of system to express, and from that, the alphabet was definitely the latest form of communication. And from alphabets, language and writing develop. Thus, the art, you can say, art is the mother of all languages, and the basic spontaneous tool. Okay, that man used to express. It was the basic spontaneous tools, because the man first, you know, they had this sound, they had this gesture, and they started writing. So it's the most primitive form of communication, you know, from the very beginning. So let's, every language has its limitation, and it cannot be understood universally. Though, you know, from the pictograph or pictures or art, you know, develop all the alphabets and all the languages, but since it's a first world, this world is so big, it is impossible to understand everything from everywhere. So if you know, like let's say three languages, four languages, it's not enough to communicate to the world. So this is, I'll give you a very funny example of how still in this 21st century, this is relevant. You know, this art is a communication tool, okay? So every language has its limitation and it cannot be understood universally, but the art doesn't have any boundaries. How? Let us see. When the verbal expression is not possible or unable to express needs or feelings, art can offer a fun, nonverbal, symbolic means of communication. So let us see how this is. This is like, you know, there are two Indian languages, and then there's a Italian, there's a French, and there's a Siberian and Chinese. So this is the, you know, they are asking for something for their breakfast, you know, like, you know, that let's say we have gone to some unknown places. And we are asking in our own language, the language we know, for our something we need for the breakfast. Let us see, like, you know, how we can communicate to picture that. So this is like, you know, let's say we have written that also, like, you know, the language is uttered there, or like, you know, that verbally they are asking for something. So this is written here. Okay. So this will be the top, this is Bengali, then there's a Tamil, and then there's a Italian, Chinese, and Arabic. So, but I don't think any of us, like, you know, until unless we know that language, we can just read that. So someone is asking verbally, it is not possible. You are writing that, it is not possible. But now you see. I hope all of you understood this, like, you know, the sketches of eggs. And the next is, like, you know, broken egg. And you understand what we want. It's an omelette we want for breakfast. And it's very easy to get it, you know, when you just draw it and show it to the restaurant owner or anything. So that's, I was like, you know. So therefore, it's very clear that the art is an effective medium of communication even in this 21st century. Let us go to see that in a modern day, how we use this, you know, you can logograph, ideograph, and all. If you don't call it a, you know, the ideograph and logograph, it's a logo. Okay, you can say it's a logo. Logo, we know, like, in the face of any company or any person, if you see that, you know, even knowing without knowing any language, you know that what that represents. See, like, let's say this is the symbol, okay? We can call it ideograph, the idea, you know, we are graphically representing in this 21st century, and we know it's no horn. And this is like, you know, all the road symbol, it does not have any language, you don't need to accept the stop and the 50, you just don't need to understand anything, but you know what are the happening there. It's all symbolic, it's all very symbolic. And this is a lot of logo, like, you know, when we see this, we know it's Adobe, when we know it's Adidas, when you see, like, you know, this is the ice cream. It's all connected with all our, this MasterCard, this, you know, like, in it's a burger, you know, all these things, KFC, and everything is without body, without, there's no alphabet. There's some of the logo, they have alphabet. Apple is a, like, you know, the most famous thing. So when you see, you know what is the product, because that is like, you know, that's connected with your visual memory. Okay, so let me, so art communicates every day, everywhere, without language. Even there's no language, but we have a communication with our everyday objects, and that communication is, if something is very nice, we know it's nice, you know. So that is also like communicating with your senses. So wake up and you see, like, you know, there's something that designed by someone that you picture to you. I'll go quick to your toothpaste and everything. If you're unable to, like, you know, read it, but you still know it's your toothpaste, because that's, those brands are like connected with this. Look at the brush and everything. This is all, like, you know, the non-verbal communication with objects. So if you see nice design, clothes, textile across the globe, it is, like, you know, it will look nice, or it will look, you know, beautiful or whatever, because it is not a written or verbal communication. It is the communication of your eyes, etc. a visual communication. Look, even if you think this is very fancy and everybody knows this is the modern design. The modern, you talk about your product of your, all these products are the nice products we all do. Okay, let's see, because I think I'm running out of time. So let me go quick through this. Yes. So it's like, you know, already 12:16. So this, even in history, you know, all this wall mural and everything, if you see it, there's nothing written. But if you look at this, you know, across the country, across the globe, it's all there. So it's a sculpture, painting, and the murals. Go to Sistine Chapel and see that, you know, it's the story from the Bibles. And you don't, if you don't know the story of Bible, but if you see it minutely, every incident you can see what is happening. Because that is what the, like, you know, and all the, like, in a mural of India abroad, you know, all the all of our temple architecture, there are a lot of murals, you know, the sculpture onto the wall, and you can see from those sculptures, you know, what is this. So this is what, like, you know, I call it a mass communication, because when you are communicating with the mass, not the person who is only studying art, you know, that when you go to any places like this, any church, any temple, anywhere, and, you know, from the sculpture outside to painting inside or painting outside, it shows that, you know, there's a communication. Look at the communication. It's just a simple mother and child, and it changes with times, but the feelings is the same. You don't need to say anything. Look at the three different tenses. Picasso, the initial use, Kartikeya Chandra. So this is that resolution, mother and child. With times, things are changing, but the communication is the same. And through the art, there's a two kind of communication. One is narratives or direct, another is abstract. When it is the abstract communication, you don't need to know, like, you know, many languages, but art has a, like, you know, the very versatile languages, has a multi-dimensional, so many people across the globe can understand that the same feelings, because the feelings are all very common in human beings. You know, the sadness is sadness, the happiness is happiness for everybody across the globe. So this is what, like, you know, church made by Matisse. And when we do it, always we do it for a mass communication, to communicate with you. So this is, before I end it up, so I'll talk about, this is the Guernica, all of us know it, Picasso. So Picasso was, like, you know, very, very devastated from the war, and he just expressed his things, and it was on the wall of the front, so people can, like, you know, see and they feel that, and it's also our documentation. And from this, all of us can find out a story or narratives. Okay, so then, as usual, there's the Indian murals, and you can see about, like, Ajanta, Ellora, and everything, which is just, you know, to make it concise, I just kept it there. Let us come to the, like, you know, very, very applied things about, like, you know, so what we all know, what is picture story. Let us see what is this picture story is all about. This little girl is, like, you know, digging the soil. She's putting the sheet and, like, you know, pouring water. Now she saw that there's a, you know, budding, and then she is, like, you know, she is, like, witnessing that there's a flower in that tree. It's very four frame, you know, storyboard, where there's nothing, no language. Across the globe, if you take this board, this experimentation of that, you know, the visual art, everybody understand and communicate. So everybody is hungry, they're thinking about time and the things, and that someone, like a mother, most probably the serving the food, they're eating it, and everybody is showing the thumbs up. Is that there is, like, you know, this nice, lovely people. So look, you don't need any language. So I think, you know, I'm just kind of have proven you guys how still it is a great tool for to communicate globally when you just don't require any language. And of course, I'm not saying that language is not important, but, you know, learning that so many languages is not possible at times, and then you can just use that art as a tool of your communication. Look at this, the cat was thinking of fish. She went fishing, she got a fish, she's eating. So that's the thing. Okay, this is my last part of the presentation. Look at this. This is a very famous artist called Banksy. Many of you must be knowing. So when that Banksy is street art, it's the form of absolutely very new things. And he's very famous, trust me. The Banksy is the like Shah Rukh Khan in the art world. So he's very popular and it's all street art. And why we do street art? To convey the message to the mass. Do you know that this is there's two political power is like, you know, dividing the India. So that's what I kept this. You can see that this is the love sign, and it's at the same time balloon is going away. So the peace is going away from us. So you can just see this, there's a burning things and all, or they're all have a message, and you know when you are aware of your surroundings and the time, you know, how relevant this is. This is a all of us know this Steve Jobs, and it is showing that Steve Jobs is carrying something and going somewhere, and he has got a very strange loop because it's talking about the migration problem, you know, and that is what these things. And this is lust, but it can be continued to this. So look at this. This is the Banksy's latest work. Since it's a pop art, it's a street art, it is for a mass people, for a mass communication. And you know that what, this is a very Dutch lady, and it's a painting, we all know, but we just painted it in a black and white and added a mask because of the coronavirus. Thank you guys. That's all for today. It was more, but I believe that we'll have another session.
Thank you, Kumud sir. Thank you, Kartikeya sir, for all the knowledge and information you have imparted us. We look forward.
Thanks a lot. Farah, would you like me to tell the students the admission criteria for the BFA Applied Art?
I have a very small presentation. Maybe I'll just.
We have a very flexible criteria. I can just tell them verbally also that we are open to all the students who are 10+2 pass, irrespective of the board. They just have to score the passing marks. The basic.
Or wedding में कोई restriction नहीं है, वो ही लोगों की restriction.
Tanya, you are on
or
unmuted. Tanya?
Interstate travel में कोई restriction नहीं है,
I think, was Tanya audible?
Yes, sir. You continue, sir.
So you just have to score the passing marks depending on your board in your 12th class. You can be from any stream, whether humanities, science, commerce, so that's not an issue. And secondly, you have filled the form, then we will be calling you for a short small interactive session in which you are free to bring some of your any kind of artworks if you have tried in your 10th or 12th class, or as your pastime also, as a hobby also. But it is not a compulsion. You can also come without any artwork and just come for an interactive session with us. And then depending on your interview and all, then we will going to admit you for this new applied art course. So anything else, Farah?
Sure, sir. I'll share the numbers with the students, maybe in case they want to contact us.
So, can you share the admission process and the contact details of the admission team? I think that'd be helpful.
I think Deepthi Khandpal is there. Deepthi is there?
Yeah, I think Deepthi is there, but I think since Kartikeya sir has already talked about under admissions, he's already talked about the admission criteria, I'll just inform the numbers as well. We can also send out the mail with all the details. So just for an added information, we are offering finance already. Sir has told you about the entire details. We are also offering Bachelor of Science Building Projects this year from the academic session 2021. So these are the details for the admission team. You can contact Deepthi and Subhi anytime. Feel free to contact us as well. We'll share these details, these contact details over the mail as well. So hope to see you here. And I'll stop the presentation part. Any questions from the presenters as well? Or we can
close the meeting. I think everything went smoothly, and this Kumud sir has shown an excellent presentation because it was quite relevant for the students who wanted to go for applied art discipline, also in general. So I think we had a great session, and let's see next week we can make it more exciting. I will get back to you, Farah. Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, guys.
Or anything, Farah, you just call me, or I will call you. So there's no issue. Okay. So take care. And if you can just request Abhishek, if he can provide us with the recording, it will be great.
So thank you everyone for joining us.
Okay, Farah, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, guys.